What you see in front of me is probably the two devices that I've gotten the most comments about in the past couple of weeks. Most of my recent videos have been talking about DaVinci Resolve for the iPad. And in every single one of those videos, a ton of people commented, well, why would you buy an iPad when for the same price, sometimes even cheaper, you can get a MacBook Pro and get full-blown DaVinci Resolve. And so today I want to see the pros and cons of DaVinci Resolve on both the iPad and the computer. I decided to put my latest 2022 48-hour film festival film on these hard drives, and I'm going to use these on both devices. So obviously mobile devices are great, laptops and tablets, but you see, I'm used to my Mac Pro, which has over 10 ports on it so I can connect all my peripherals. And for a long time, I've been missing that type of connection with my MacBook Pro. But thanks to the latest Anker 563 and 565, 10 and 11 in one hub, these issues are issues of the past. With the Anker 563 10 in one USB-C type docking station, you can add up to three separate monitors via two HDMI ports and one display port. You can run power with up to a 100-watt USB Type-C power connection, and of course you get all the other ports that you could possibly want. A USB Type-C 3.2 Gen 1, USB Type-A 3.2 Gen 1, two USB Type-A 2.0 ports, an Ethernet port, and an auxiliary in and out port. Heck, even add your phone in there with the up to 30 watts of power delivery port. There's nothing worse out there than buying cheap accessories for your computer and then being on an important set and having to transfer hundreds of gigs of files around just to have things constantly disconnect or stop working or speed slow down on you. This has never happened to me with Anker products before, which is why I love that they've been such a big supporter of this channel. Now, if you want something even more portable, you should check out the brand new 565 11-in-1 hub, which shares a lot of the same similarities as the 563. Give your laptop an extra 11 ports and get access to data transfer, charging, dual monitor, display, and more, all from a single hub. If you're looking for any hubs or docking stations for your MacBook Pros, the Anker 563 and 565, with all of their unrivaled performance, will definitely meet your needs. Check them all out in the link in the description below. Anker accidentally sent a couple more than they intended, I think, so I'm gonna give them away to you guys. Make sure you're subscribed, leave a comment down below. I'm gonna send a couple of you guys some Anker docs. Let's get back to editing. First test, let's see what a startup time looks like. Again, I know it's not perfectly fair because this one's starting up a much more intensive program than this, but within about, you know, 5-10 seconds, whatever it was, we almost have Resolve open for iPad. While these are opening, by the way, this film actually we won for best editing, so yay. All right, so let's go ahead and relink all of the media. All right, and apparently and transfer a lot of my sound, but we're mostly here for the clips. All right, so we have both projects opened up, and as I said, most of the, it looks like sound clips are not quite there, so there's that. Let's see how it does with initial playback. By the way, I should probably check, this is a 1080p timeline, so keep that in mind. We had to submit it in 1080p, they wouldn't take 4K. So this technically shouldn't even be too difficult, but we do have pretty intense color grades on here. A lot of the, pretty much all the footage required a hefty amount of noise reduction. And we have some other stylized layers here. The iPad's playback is pretty solid. Yeah, honest, the M1 MacBook Pro's playback is definitely worse off. Like, this is able to play that entire clip smoothly. Now if I turn off all the effects and go back, of course it plays back just fine. And of course, when we're looking at the user interface, we can see some interesting things happen. For the MacBook Pro, the top timeline, which shows the kind of zoom to fit, we definitely have a lot more vertical room, and I can see all of my my layers more clearly and kind of where in the film I'm at. On the iPad version, it is quite squished. So when you have projects that are quite tall, and that I'm not able to adjust. You can adjust your timeline view, but I don't believe I can adjust the top timeline. And so that's definitely a pro for the MacBook Pro. But Blackmagic has done something pretty interesting on the iPad by giving it a more adaptive interface. See, both of these devices are pretty much 13 inches. For example, if I have everything open here on the MacBook Pro, and then I go over to turn on the inspector, it basically covers half of my timeline viewer. And so then I could go over here and turn off, you know, the media pool. Actually, I can't turn that off. So I basically, how do I see my whole viewer on the cut page? I can't. I just have to like zoom out a bunch. Well, sells my point even more. On the iPad version, we have our media bin open, but as soon as I hit inspector, it's gonna close the media bin automatically, move my viewer over, and now I can see my inspector and my full viewer without losing a ton of real estate, because there's really no need to have the media bin and the inspector open, which would give me a super small viewer. It's gonna keep my viewer the same size and just move things over. And I think it's just one of those little design details that makes the experience really pleasant. Now, when we jump over to the color page, I can safely say that we have basically the same exact user interface. There are a couple extra buttons on the computer version that we don't have on the iPad version, and they're pretty much all at the top. So we have media pool, and we have timeline, which will bring up kind of like on the cut page, that mini timeline, so we can jump around very quickly. And then we have the lightbox view, which can be really nice to make sure all of your clips, and if you have multiple scenes, you can kind of see that everything is matching. Now, of course, I'm sure you've already commented down below, but Michael, what if you don't like the cut page? Yes, you can just go here and go on the edit page, which is gonna be way more feature filled. And to that, I mean, obviously there's no rebuttal. Yes, edit page, please come to the iPad. I've said that in every single video, and I'll continue to say it until I can make a video saying, hey, Blackmagic added the edit page to the iPad version. And yes, not only just the edit page, but you get the full 7 pages on the computer version compared to the 2 on here. I'm not trying to make this sound like it is the same exact experience. I understand all the comments saying, hey, you know, why would you spend money on this? Just get this. But what it really comes down to, if you are watching this video and saying, I'm debating buying, you know, one of these devices, I wanna do video editing in Resolve, but I don't know which one to choose, it comes down to the features that you need. If you're just cutting together a bunch of videos, you're doing a lot of color grading work, the iPad is truly an amazing experience. It's got a Pro Display XDR technology, so for working with HDR content, it's actually one of the best displays that you can view your footage on. And as we can see from scrubbing around this footage, like, this is all 6K B-roll, fully color graded, a bunch of noise reduction. And considering it has all that noise reduction, it's actually playing back better than I thought it would. If I was still cutting this around, I would just be turning off the effects, and then I have a really, really smooth experience on both of these devices. And considering that I actually edited this on my $10,000+ Mac Pro, is pretty incredible. What you can get for your money nowadays. Yeah, make your Mac Pro waste of money jokes. I know I keep dancing around the like decision of, you know, which one would I buy. Here's what I think I would do in its current state. And that is a very key thing to say, because I believe that Resolve for the iPad will grow to get the majority of the entire functionality that the desktop version has eventually. That could be next year, that could be 4 years from now, I have no idea. And so I can only base it off of what the initial beta release and the final release that we'll see in the next couple of weeks. If you're going, I wanna be a video editor, you know, I wanna find clients, I wanna do this, that, and the other, it probably makes the most sense to buy a full-fledged, you know, MacBook Pro or desktop, could be Windows, Resolve will run on anything. Get yourself the full version of DaVinci Resolve. While I'd really like to say that if I had no other computers, I would just use Resolve for the iPad, because I do love color grading on a touch display with the Apple Pencil. It's just a really unique and fun experience. And if most of what you're doing is cutting video together, especially if you're like a social content creator, that's really nice. Not to even mention that this is the cellular model, and so I can be anywhere and still sync all of my projects, my footage, and you can't have cellular models of MacBook Pros. I feel like I'm not being helpful in this video because I can't even decide. I genuinely think I'm gonna need your guys' help with me on this. Debate it in the comments. I wanna know, what device would you pick if you had no other device? So this is not your secondary, as your primary device, would you go iPad Pro or MacBook Pro to use DaVinci Resolve on, and why? And I would love to see your arguments for either side. Again, huge thanks to Anker for sponsoring this video. Don't forget to make sure you're subscribed and leave a comment down below, and I'm gonna pick a couple people to win those Anker docs. See you guys in the next video.